Just a quick announcement before I forget. I'm sorry that this morning there won't be any coffee or tea after our service. I apologise for this. We have a baptism at 10:45. And so we need to prepare church for the baptism. So I do apologise for that. But normal service will come back next week. Also, I'm very conscious that as we approach, God willing, the end of lockdown, which is coming sometime this summer, we don't know when we're going to get congregation singing back. But there's no reason why we can't have some singing. But we're limited to how many people we're allowed to have singing. We're only allowed to have six people sing at the moment. So if there are six strong singers out there who would like to start singing, I'm glad he had my proper teeth to say that. Will you talk to me? And then we can see if we can get something happening. But we are very, very limited at the moment in terms of how many. The government 2 weeks ago just announced that from allowing, you know, quite a few people to be able to sing, suddenly it went down to, no, you can only have six. But we had how many thousands singing at football matches and stuff yesterday, but anyway. So I leave that with you to ruminate in your heads and your prayers. As on this day we celebrate the great feast of the Holy Trinity. So let's just gather ourselves. And on this beautiful day, give thanks to God for the blessings that he gives us. And also we place before the Lord all those things which we need help for. Any worries we have, any fears we have, any anxieties that we have. And we give them to him now, as we gather together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ, be with you. Would you please sit? God the Father forgives us in Christ and heals us by the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore put away all anger and bitterness, all slander and malice, and confess our sins to God our Redeemer. Father, you come to meet us when we return to you. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Jesus, you died on the cross for our sins. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Spirit, you give us life and peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on you. Forgive your sins. Bring you to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let's stand and praise God. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
Let us pray. Holy God, faithful and unchanging, enlarge our minds with the knowledge of your truth and draw us more deeply into the mystery of your love, that we may truly worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let's sit and hear God's word.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, Holy, 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 holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among the people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a light coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the gospel. Hallelujah, hallelujah. To the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, one God who was, and who is to come. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God. Jesus answered him, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above. Nicodemus said to him, how can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of the water and the Spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about the heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
And may I speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Trinity Sunday is one of those days that preachers dread. So I'm going to put it back to you. I'm going to give you a little test, see what you know. Okay, put your thinking caps on. Okay, right. The Trinity. we're aware of every Sunday we say the creed, don't we?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we know the Apostles' Creed, don't we? How does the Apostles' Creed start? This is where it gets confusing. Go back to your prayer book days. I believe in God. Okay, Apostles' Creed, right? Nicene Creed, the Nicene Creed. It's the one that we use most regularly now. We believe in God. Yeah? And it goes on. Now then, there's another one. The Athanasian Creed. How many prayer book people remember the Athanasian Creed? Because the Athanasian Creed, if you were doing the prayer book properly, it should have been used on certain feast days, including the Trinity. And if you think that we can get confused a little bit with the Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed, have a listen to this. And now you'll really get why preachers have some dread of preaching about the Trinity. Whoever will be saved, before all things it is necessary that he hold the Catholic faith, and that's Catholic universal. Which faith accepts everyone do keep whole and undefiled, without doubt he shall perish everlastingly. And the Catholic faith is this, that we worship one God in Trinity, and Trinity in unity, neither confounding the persons nor dividing the substance. For there is one person of the Father, another of the Son, and another of the Holy Ghost. But the Godhead of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost is all one, the glory equal, the majesty co-eternal. Such as the Father is, such is the Son, and such is the Holy Ghost. The Father uncreate, the Son uncreate, and the Holy Ghost uncreate. The Father incomprehensible, the Son incomprehensible, the Holy Ghost incomprehensible. The Father eternal, the Son eternal, and the Holy Ghost eternal. And yet there are not three eternals, but one eternal. As also there are not three incomprehensibles, nor three uncreated, but one uncreated and one incomprehensible. And there's a lot more. Now do you know why we dread preaching on the Trinity? And actually, we shouldn't though. Because if we're not careful, when we approach Trinity Sunday, what we try and do sometimes is we try and turn the Trinity into a mathematical formula. And I can't do maths. I failed my maths O-level 3 times. So I can't do it. My little head just won't get it. And we overcomplicate, I think, the Trinity. Because we get mixed up in the three and this, three and that, three doesn't go, three, you know, and then we get confused. And actually, I think for myself, the way that I try and understand the Trinity, because to approach the Trinity is to actually approach something about how we understand God and how we experience God and how God makes himself, herself known to us, how we experience. As human beings, we're tactile, aren't we? We're made of stuff. And so, you know, we have to relate to things in that sort of way, don't we? And, you know, we relate to God in that way. And yet I think that the Trinity is the purest and the most perfect expression of a relationship of God, who makes himself known to us through the Creator Father, through the redeeming Son, through the power and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. God who is interwoven, but God who makes himself known to us, thank God, through Jesus, who we can relate to. We can relate to Jesus because Jesus was flesh and blood, like us. But yet Jesus draws us into something much deeper. Jesus draws us into the relationship of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Creator, the Redeemer, the Inspirer. And he draws us into a perfect relationship of love. And that's what the Trinity is. The Trinity is a perfect relationship of love. And this feast day of the Trinity reminds us that we are being invited again and again and again, that we are being drawn into that relationship of love. That God loves the world so much, as we heard in the Gospel, that he sent his only Son, that Jesus became one like us. Because God knew that we got it wrong. God knew that at some point in our human history, there was a perfect relationship of love between God's creation and between God's creation and God. And yet, God's creation messed that up. And ever since, the Lord God had been trying to draw us back in. And through his Son, he offers that. God loved the world so much that he sent his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. And do you know what? As Christians, as we are drawn into that relationship of love, we're also called to mirror that relationship. We're called to be that relationship. Because in God's world, which is our world, love isn't this wishy-washy thing that can be dismissed and we can talk about, oh, I love you and love you and whatever. It's just words. That's not God's love. The love of God is action. The love of God is doing. The love of God is made visible. And it's made visible through relationship. It's made visible through the relationship of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we make that, we make God visible through our relationships. So whenever we talk about the God of love, then we have to be prepared to say the God of love is how I live. The God of love is how I speak. The God of love is how I think. The God of love is what I do. Because I believe that I am being invited into a relationship with God every second of my life. And so, on this feast of the Trinity, let's not go formulaic. Let's not go mathematical. Let's just bring it back to understanding that God is love, and that God loves us, and that God wants us to love whoever we meet, as difficult as that might be, and that people will encounter God through the relationships that we have with each other and through the relationships that we have with people we encounter. And of course, for us as a parish, for us as a benefice, that has massive implications for us in terms of how do we relate, how do we show, how do we give the love of God to the people who pass this building every day, to the people who pass our houses every day. God is inviting us all the time into his closer, nearer presence of love. And we are invited to reflect that love to others, so that through our example, through our relationships, that others may be drawn into it, so that they too may encounter Jesus. He who came among us, he who was sent by the Father, who loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. That's God's love in a nutshell, isn't it? He wants everyone to have eternal life with him, because he loves us. some people comment or observe at times that I make the sign of the cross, other people make the sign of the cross. It's something I've done all my life. Yes, it's part of my upbringing, but I don't do it to make any political statement. I make the sign of the cross because for me, it's a physical action. For me, when I say it in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I'm touching myself, I'm prodding myself. And the sign of the cross, which we begin every service with, and which we end every service with, is a reminder that we come together in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And it's a reminder to us that everything that we do is to be in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so next time you make the sign of the cross, next time you say in the name of the Father, it doesn't matter if you cross yourself physically or mentally, what you are saying is, I am going to do everything in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, that my life is going to be influenced through the name of God, who is Father, who is Son, who is Holy Spirit. So if you see me or anybody else making a physical sign of the cross, don't get hooked up about it. But just remind ourselves that actually, whenever we say it, whenever we do it, we're making a statement to ourselves, and we're making a commitment that everything that we do is going to be in God's name. And God reveals himself to us as the Father, as the Son, as the Holy Spirit. And God reveals himself as a relationship of pure love. And he invites us into that relationship. Amen. So now we are going to profess our faith in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Something that often washes over us because, again, it's something that we say regularly. But perhaps just take a little bit more notice today of what you are saying, what you are professing to, of what we as Christians, of we as church, believe. Let's start. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was taken out. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Let us pray.
May hear your voice and call and declare the mystery of your love to and strengthen the bonds of our united benefice. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Lord, you bring healing and reconciliation. Restore us in your image and give rest to the weary and hope to all who despair. We remember especially Sandra Booth, Anne Cullen, John Kitchener, Vicky Hornby, Gordon Scott, Ruth Sumner, Sandra Hurst, Francis Kane, Ross McClumford, Emma Garr, Victoria Rundle, Steve Race, Marlene Dookie, Tony Seal, Mary Watkin, Louise Stanley, Paul Jackson. Lord, in your mercy, Holy Lord, your will is to save, not to condemn. Look in mercy upon all who have died, and bring us to share with the life of your eternity. We remember Hilda Hughes, whose anniversary is around this time. Lord, in your mercy, merciful Father, accept and pray.
Peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father. Peace from his Son, Jesus Christ, who is our peace. Peace from the Holy Spirit, the life-giver. And the peace of the triune God be with you always. Peace be with you. Please have a seat. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, give us the bread of life, of everlasting life, and make us branches of the true vine. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For with your only begotten Son and the Holy Spirit, you are one God, one Lord. All that you reveal of your glory, the same we believe of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, without any difference or inequality. We, your Holy Church, acclaim you, Father of Majesty unbounded, your true and only Son, worthy of all worship, and the Holy Spirit, advocate and guide. Three persons we adore, one in being and equal in majesty. And so with angels and archangels, with cherubim and seraphim, we praise you as we say, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to be in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Apostles, St. Leonard, St. Aidan, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Lamb of God. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Holy One is here. Come.
Wednesday evening, so you're very, very welcome to come along to that to support Andrew and his family, and also to enjoy the company of Bishop Philip. It's great that we can have him with us. So that's Wednesday evening at 7 o'clock. On a personal point of view, can I ask you prayers, please, for this afternoon? Blackpool are at Wembley. I'd love them to win. Because I'd love them to be playing North End and Blackburn and other local teams next season. So, come on, you Tangerine visitors, that's all I'm going to say. Let's stand for our blessing. And whatever you do for the rest of the bank holiday, please do enjoy it. Enjoy the weather, stay safe, and remember relationships of love. How we act, what we do, what we say, people take notice of. And if it's not in line with what we believe, then people take notice. If it is in line with what we believe, then it makes people ask questions. That's what we want them to be doing, so that we can answer them and draw them into that relationship of love with God and with each other in our parishes. The Lord be with you. God the Father, who first loved us and made us accepted and beloved in the beloved Son, bless you.
Amen.
God the Son, who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, bless you.
Amen.
God the Holy Spirit, who sheds abroad the love of God in our hearts, bless you.
Amen.
The blessing of the one true God, to whom be all love and all glory for time and for eternity, come down upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.
Oh, beauty for brokenness, hope for despair. Lord, in the suffering, this is our prayer. Bread for the children, justice, joy, peace. Sunrise to sunset, your kingdom increase. Shelter for fragile lives, cure for their ills. Work for the craftsman, trade for their skills. Land for the dispossessed, rights for the weak. Voices to plead the cause of those who can't speak. God of the poor, friend of the weak, give us compassion, we pray. Melt our cold hearts, the tears fall like rain. Come change our love from a spark to a flame. Refuge from cruel wars, haven.